Hi, thank you so much for joining us today. Learn more about WCN's Rising Wildlife Leaders programs and to hear from some of our amazing conservation participants. My name is Laura Gruber. I am a senior programs manager at WCN who focuses on supporting early career conservationists through these programs. As we're going through these presentations, if you have any questions that you'd like to ask any of us that are on this call, please feel free to drop them in the chat and we will cover as many as we can as we get to the end. As you might know, WCN has three main pillars. The foundation on which WCN was built is our partner network. We identify and partner with amazing community-based conservation organizations who are working to ensure wildlife and people coexist and thrive. Our second pillar, the Wildlife Funds, is focused on consolidating resources to support specific species that are facing extraordinary risks and in order to curtail those threats that they are facing. And then our newest pillar, which I'm so excited to share more with you about today, is the Rising Wildlife Leaders. And this pillar focuses on supporting local conservationists to grow and thrive. We invest in early to mid-career conservationists to strengthen their skills, build their organizations, and advance their careers in conservation. And I'm going to cover quickly just a few of those programs before we go on to our guest speakers. The Rising Wildlife Leaders programs focus on three main areas of support: providing capacity building and skills development, providing strong networks that are so key to long-term success, to offering peer support and professional collaboration and senior mentorship throughout a career. And then additionally, the core resources such as leadership, training, and financial support. One of the main barriers to early career conservationists entering the field is the limited availability of applied learning opportunities where hands-on experience can be gained, initial mentorship, and professional networks can be established. While we don't talk about it often, WCN actually began an internship program back in 2012 with our partner network. Beginning this year, we're expanding it in scope in order to be able to reach our wildlife funds and our scholarship alumni. The program offers financial support to cover the costs of hosting or participating in an internship for in-country nationals. These programs provide career development for early career conservationists while also supporting critical conservation work. They often act as a stepping off point into the employment and conservation careers. Beginning in 2006, WCN's scholarship program has a long history of providing graduate degrees and postgraduate trainings to early to mid-career conservationists who are working in their home region. I think it's really important to note here the home region component to this, because it's vital that local communities and individuals are empowered to manage their own landscapes and wildlife. Scholarships are awarded in three categories: conservation broadly, which focuses a specific focus on individuals committed to working closely within their local communities. We also have a veterinary focus, either as wildlife veterinarians or as One Health practitioners, which are working at the intersection of disease transmission between humans, livestock, and wildlife. And then our newest scholarship, which launched just this last year, which is providing opportunities to Indigenous students in the United States who are leading conservation efforts in their local landscapes. Unlike most scholarship programs elsewhere, the financial support that WCN provides can be used for any as necessary expenses, including housing and transportation, which is really rare. In 2022, we launched our new capacity building initiative called the Career Program. This is currently focused in Africa, but we are aiming to expand it in future years. And this program focuses on providing early to mid-career conservationists the capacity building and financial support that's needed to continue in and thrive in the field of conservation. This three-year program provides multiple years of support to ensure participants' long-term success. And participants receive tailor-made training programs which are catered to their career ambitions, formal mentorship support with mentors who are identified to best guide them in their career development, and a financial stipend to be used as needed most. In total, we've had over 200 participants from nearly 50 countries come through our scholarship, career, and internship programs. You're going to be hearing from a couple of those today. And the faces you see here are just a small representation of our alumni network, who are all making amazing contributions to conservation in their local communities. I did want to take a really quick opportunity to highlight two familiar faces, probably to many of you, that really exemplify how impactful investing in local leaders can be. At the time of Dr. Shivani Bala's WCN scholarship application, she was a wildlife biologist with Save the Elephants. She had recently completed a master's focused on lions and was pursuing a doctorate to further her interests in that species. Shortly after receiving her scholarship, WCN offered her additional sponsorship for another capacity building program called the Emerging Wildlife Conservation Leaders. And today, Shivani is the founder and director of Owosso Lions. Quite an impressive journey. When Peter LaLampa applied for WCN scholarship, he was the field program coordinator with Grovey Zebra Trust, pursuing a master's degree focused on population management. Like Shivani, WCN also sponsored him for additional capacity building. And today, Peter's the director of programs and a member of the senior leadership at Grovey Zebra Trust, and we're very proud to say a member of the WCN board of directors. While these are only two representations of our alumni network, they all have their own individual stories. Today, I'm thrilled to introduce you to Nelson and Bridget so that they may share their own stories with you. They are both current participants in our Rising Wildlife Leaders programs and doing inspiring work to conserve wildlife. Nelson's a 2022 WCN scholar, a mapping specialist with Save the Elephants in Kenya. He manages the Save the Elephants tracking systems while pursuing his PhD in ecology at Colorado State University. Bridget is a 2022 career participant and a wildlife ecologist with the Zambian Carnivore Program. Her work focuses on research and monitoring in addition to empowering aspiring young conservationists. We're incredibly fortunate to have both of them with us today. Nelson is currently in the States for coursework, and Bridget is joining us from Kenya, where she is currently attending one of the trainings that the career program supports. And full disclosure, we've been struggling with some connectivity with Bridget, so we're hoping we're gonna be able to navigate through that on this session. But regardless, please continue to make sure we're putting in our questions into the chat, and we'll make sure we get all of the answers to you. And with that, it's off to you, Nelson.
Well, hello, everyone. My name is Nelson Mwangi. I'm a third-year PhD student at Colorado State University, studying ecology, mainly focusing on elephant species and movements. I also work for Save the Elephants, as Laura said, tracking manager for all our color data. I've been working with them for the past 5 years. And recently I'm a beneficiary of the WCN Sydney Bias Scholarship. And I know most of you know what we do at Save the Elephants, but for those of you who are not aware of Save the Elephants, I'll give a brief introduction of what we do, and then I'll dive into the scholarship part of my presentation. So basically, Save the Elephants' mission is to secure a future for elephants and to sustain the beauty and ecological integrity of the places where they live in. And where they live in, for where I work, is Samburu in northern Kenya. And above that is to develop a tolerant relationship between the elephants and other wildlife and people. And so to achieve this, Save the Elephants has two pillars, and one of them is wildlife and the other one is people. For the wildlife part, SDE conducts extensive research on elephant behavior and ecology by daily field observations across Kenya and using GPS tracking devices across Africa since 1998. So the Samburu population especially has become one of the world's best studied population, and it continues to be studied especially by upcoming conservationists and researchers such as I. To ensure this coexistence between elephants and people, SDE's goals have a human dimension pillar, which mainly involves corridoring livestock, elephant interaction monitoring, which we have employed local community members to monitor livestock and also wildlife corridors, and to ensure the integrity of these corridors is maintained by ensuring the coexistence between people and wildlife. Another dimension is the human wildlife conflict mitigation. So we try and do our level best to mitigate human wildlife conflicts. And a big example is our elephants and bees organization down in Tsavo. So they use beehive fences to try and mitigate human wildlife conflict. And it has been a very successful project, employing very many local community members and also creating more awareness about human elephant conflict. And to build up on the human dimension aspect, STE has an education and scholarship pillar. And the goal of this pillar is to create elephant ambassadors through mobile education, school visits, high school and university scholarships, and community awareness. And this has helped hundreds, if not thousands of children and upcoming conservationists to follow their dreams, be they in conservation or other career paths. We have had doctors, we have had accountants come from this scholarship program. And personally, I have benefited so much from this program, which was a major stepping stone to my PhD, and I cannot be more grateful to Save the Elephants and also to the WCN scholarship. So other than getting most of my PhD financial from ST, I'm also very privileged to be a beneficiary of the WCN Sydney Bear Scholarship. And this scholarship has helped me in so many ways. If you think about COVID and if you think all the challenges international students have to go through, this scholarship has helped pay for my tuition, which can be very expensive. So if you compare tuition here and tuition back in Africa, tuition here can be very expensive, but also the quality of education can be very great. And so I'm very grateful for that. And another huge thing is living expenses. As you know, it's a developed country, the United States. So living here can be very expensive, but the WCN scholarship has helped offset some of this cost and ensuring that I can at least focus on my PhD. And another thing, other than the cost here in Fort Collins in Colorado, the WCN scholarship will go a very long way to help pay for travel back home to see family, which is very important. So I wanna keep that in mind and also collect data for my PhD. So I'm collecting a lot of elephant movement data. And so basically my PhD involves studying elephant species and trying to understand the drivers of these species. And so I'll be going back and forth to Kenya, and the WCN scholarship will help pay for field work, which I like, and also help me spend time with these amazing creatures in the field, which I've missed. Also travel back home and back here to finish my PhD. And what's next? Basically, what's next after my PhD? My goal is to be a mentor for the next generation of conservationists and guardians of nature, such as like I've benefited from this from previous people who have gone through this scholarship, like Rason, who works for Oasis Lions now. So I wanna take that position and step in Rason's shoes, which are quite big, and try and, you know, mentor the next generation of scholars through the ST program, scholarship program, and hopefully the WCN. And other than that, my main career goal is to use all the knowledge and tools from my PhD and ST and WCN experience to play my part in conservation and to contribute to the protection of, as you all know, this majestic and intelligent species, but which is also at risk from various factors ranging from climate change to poaching. So I hope to use all these tools and the knowledge to at least play my part in conservation and be part of this huge conservation network, including you and WCN and upcoming scholars. So thank you so much for that, for listening. Quite a brief presentation, but I'm very excited to be here. And now I'm going to hand it back to Aurora, who will introduce our next speaker, Bridget. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Nelson. That was amazing. We are continuing to have some connectivity challenges, so we're going to go ahead and play a pre-recorded version of Bridget's session so that you guys get the full experience and be able to hear her story from her. Megan, if you would like to pull that up.
Hello everyone, my name is Bridget Mayani. I'm a senior ecologist at Zambian Carnivore Programme. Zambian Carnivore Programme is a conservation organization whose mission is to conserve large carnivores and the ecosystems they reside in. We do this through four pillars. One is conservation science, where we monitor large carnivores and collect data to identify threats posed on large carnivores. Conservation action is the second pillar that we use to address threats posed on large carnivores. And conservation leadership is a pillar that allows us to promote local leadership. And coexistence is the fourth pillar that helps us to reduce the cost of living with wildlife around protected areas. We operate in three main areas, which is South Bonga National Park, Kafue National Park, and Liwa Plain National Park. I'm currently stationed at South Bonga National Park, where our headquarters are. I joined Wildlife Conservation Network Career Program in 2022, was one of the first cohort members. The career program has helped me to benefit in three main areas. One is career growth, access to mentorship, and financial support. Since I became a career program participant, my career has actually grown in a number of ways. One is I was able to attend the Congress, which is the African Protected Area Congress that was held in Rwanda. And there, for the first time, I was able to present about the work that we're doing to people that are in conservation and people that are interested in conservation sector. Through this same Congress, I was able to learn a lot from others what they are doing in conservation and the methods that they're using to actually conserve wildlife in Africa and the world at large. Through this program, I have also done three certificate courses. Two are ongoing and one I've already completed, which is a proposal writing and fundraising masterclass. For the proposal writing and fundraising masterclass, this course has enabled me to be confident in proposal writing and also to participate effectively in fundraising of funds in our organization. Then two ongoing courses, one is project management. I believe this course will enable me to effectively manage the projects that will be given in my hands to manage. And also there's a behavior-centered design that I'm currently doing. This course is giving me insight on behavior, attitude, and beliefs when dealing with people in the community or conservation. I've also done three online courses, and these are free courses that enabled me to just have an insight of what the certificate courses would look like. So the free online courses consisted of project management, grant writing, and also one which is not related to a certificate course is science communication. This course has enabled me to have just an idea on how you can communicate effectively in science. And I'm planning to have more certificate courses coming up, and I believe this will contribute to my career growth. The career program has enabled me to have access to mentorship. I'm currently being mentored by one of Zambia's most incredible conservationist. Her name is Tandiwe Mwitwa. I'm getting her guidance from her, and I'm learning a lot from her, which is a plus for me and my career growth. Through this career program, I've received financial support that has enabled me to actually do my passion project, which is integrated field conservation course. Growing up, I never had an opportunity to listen or hear from mentors or people out there that are in conservation sector. I drew up my passion for conservation through wildlife documentaries on TV, through the books that I was reading, and so on. But I never had role models to relate to, and I never had an idea that conservation is actually a career option in my country. I thought you would, if you want to do conservation, you would have to go away from Zambia to be able to pursue that career. And so I learned about the program when I started applying for something different than what I was passionate about. And because of this, I came up with this project, or I thought of this project because I wanted to bridge those gaps that I once walked through in my career path. Apart from that, I've been able to cater for living expenses, office supplies, and equipment through this support. And I'm going to dive into details about the integrated food conservation course. So this course is designed for urban secondary school students or graduates, and then urban undergraduates or early graduates. For urban secondary school graduates, this program is designed to like give them just an idea of what conservation is, and to also be a mentor or be a role model to them, and to give conservation as a career option to them. For urban undergraduates or early graduates, we are using this program to actually equip them with skills that they need, or skills that they've learned about but they've never had an opportunity to actually get a hands-on experience. Training in this program consists of radio tracking skills using the radio telemetry, using GPS, and also we get to attach our students to the Human Wildlife Conflict department, where they're able to learn different skills and different methods that we use to help reduce the cost of living with wildlife. We also get them involved with immobilizations, changing collars or fitting collars, removing snares, so that they get hands-on experience. Apart from that, we're also equipping them with technical skills that can be used to conserve wildlife, and one of which is GIS, where they're able to use this application to design maps or make maps for the programs that we're doing, or the activities that we do with the GPS. They collect data and then they come up with a map from those activities. We end this program with a one-on-one discussion between the participants and management, to just hear from the participants how best we can improve on this program, and how also they've found the program, or how they found the program, whether it was interesting to them, whether they learned something from it, and so on. And at the end of it all, we give them a certificate of attendance. And we also add them to our social media platform, which is WhatsApp, where we are constantly monitoring their progress, how they're doing after the integrated field course. So this program, we run it for 1 to 2 weeks, and we're looking forward to improve on the duration of this course. The participants benefit in a number of ways. They get practical work experience and training. No registration no registration fee is attached to this course. It is for free, and no one else is doing this in Zambia. We get to cater for their travel expenses, accommodation is provided, meals are covered, and we give them a certificate, and we assist them with a job search. This is something that is unique and something that you cannot easily get elsewhere or in Zambia. We've been able to reach a total number of 55 secondary school students and 35 undergraduates and 4 teachers through this same program. So we do a presentation at the target schools, where we just give an introduction to Zambian Kangaroo program and conservation at large. And then we identify students that are interested in conservation as a career option. And those are the ones that we get to have participate in our integrated field conservation course. So in 2022, we had a total number of 3 students from these institutions where we did the presentations. And then 3 from 2 different institutions that we didn't do any presentation, and the total number of 6 students that participated in our field integrated field conservation course. A broader impact is one of the participants is currently working for Center for Primary Care Research. And he says, I'm currently working as a research assistant for Center for Primary Care Research. I'm capable of making maps that show points in our sampling area using GIS. And this is a skill that he learned through the integrated field conservation course. And I'm proud to have him play a major role in that sector. Another participant is one who attended one of the introductory presentations at the institutions from the Copperbelt University. His name is Samlapo. He says the internship period with ZCP has equipped me with field practical and technical skills. This training has enabled me to link the theoretical principles studied at the university and the practical conservation work carried out. Samlapo was given an internship period of 3 months with us in Lower Plains National Park, and we identified him through the talks that we did. I'm also equally proud to have him play such a major role in our organization. I'm looking forward to seeing all the participants have something to do after this training program, and I'm also very grateful for Wildlife Conservation Network for this opportunity that has been given to me. And a big thank you to the donors for WCN. Your donation are not going in vain. They're actually working massively in our lives to improve us as conservationists in our early careers. Thank you very much.
I loved seeing all of the chats coming in for Bridget's amazing work with younger emerging leaders in conservation and her space. She's really doing some fantastic work with that community. Unfortunately, I don't think we have a strong connection with Bridget still. She is able to take questions via chat, so please do pop those in. We're going to be responding via text in real time, and I'll try to get those questions and answers back to you guys. In the meantime, we do have Nelson connected, and I'd like to take the opportunity to ask some questions of Nelson, but while we're doing that, please continue to pop questions in the chat. We're going to open it up to guest chat here shortly, and we'd love to be able to cover all of the information that you guys want to have covered. So Nelson, love hearing about your work. Thank you so much for covering those details with us. It's really inspirational and excited to see the end results of your dissertation. Wanting to get a little bit to kind of the intricacies of how challenging it is to get started in the conservation field. To start, can you tell us how you first became interested in conservation and what made you commit to a career in conservation in general, or more specifically with elephants?
Well, speaking of challenges, like coming from a developing country, careers like being a doctor, being a pilot, like high-paying careers are always encouraged. And the funny thing is I did my undergraduate in Nairobi, and the first course I took was aeronautical engineering. So I wanted to be an aeronautical engineer, but we're given a week of changing courses. So I took the first ecology course just to try it out and haven't looked back since then. And I switched from aeronautical engineering to environmental science. And during my third year, I took an internship with Dr. Lucy King of Elephants and Bees. And I was down in Savo for about 3 months. And I loved that experience so much. And I couldn't see myself doing anything other than conservation, especially elephants and working with local communities. I'm also very passionate about traditional, or what you'd call indigenous knowledge systems.
That's fantastic. We have, so continuing on that point of the challenges and not always having the familial support too of getting into conservation, we talked earlier about how challenging it is to get in the first place and then really to thrive within it. Can you tell us a little bit more about what opportunities helped you? You mentioned Lucy King, but if there's anything in more detail in that to help to get you into the field, and then what opportunities have been presented to you since you've been in conservation that help you to continue to grow and thrive?
So I think what helped me get into conservation is just taking internships. I took numerous internships and volunteer work. So I've volunteered for various organizations across Kenya. And through that, I made connections and I became involved with conservation at a more advanced level. I took an internship with Kenya Wildlife Service, which is like the main wildlife management organization in Kenya. And then after Lucy's, I went to Save the Elephants as an intern for 6 months. And I did like a free internship. I think someone asked that in the chat. So I volunteered with Save the Elephants. So when you volunteer with them, you gain a lot of knowledge. And I think that paved the way into making it into conservation. And I think once you volunteer enough and you know you play your own tiny part, it paves way to go deeper into conservation. So working with Save the Elephants has helped me to first come here and do my PhD and also grow my conservation career. And then WCN came in. So I feel like all my internships and, you know, volunteering and hard work and then connections with Save the Elephants and WCN helped me a lot.
That's good to hear. I'm glad that we were able to support and in part thanks to some of the amazing guests that we have on this call. Expanding kind of on that a little bit more, what kind of opportunities do you think are going to continue to help you to grow in this career field? A PhD is obviously an enormous step in that space, but do you think there's additional support that you've seen others in senior leadership get along the way that would benefit you in that process?
I think being involved more with the communities and taking on leadership roles in the communities I'm working in, I think has helped a lot of people. So that's my goal, like to identify these opportunities as they come in. Other than the PhD, I wanna be as involved with the local community as I can and also to maintain contact with like donors and partners and people like the WCN, and also we work with a lot of other NGOs in Kenya. So maintaining that collaboration as a conservation field, like that helps a lot.
Awesome, that's good to know. Knowing how challenging it is to get into and continue on into, do you have any specific advice for young conservationists that are just getting started?
Well, first advice is to do as many volunteer work, volunteer to organizations you're passionate about on the ground or even remotely, just volunteer as much as you can. And then don't give up, don't despair. I know conservation, like the outputs from conservation can be slow. Like the outcome is slow to see because it takes time. Don't despair, even if you're just going out and collecting data in the field for a day, don't give up and say, oh, in 50 years, we have achieved this and this. So just continue going and be passionate about what you're doing. So I'm passionate about elephants and also GIS, which is Geographic Information System. So making maps. So be passionate about whatever you're interested in conservation and follow your passion. And I think it pays off, as you can see from Bridget and I.
I think that's really good advice. The perseverance to continue to push through, I know is one of the characteristics that most who have succeeded in this field like to share with the next generation and specifically around the passion behind it. I think most will agree that this is a career of passion. That's kind of how folks get into the field in the first place. So it's so nice to hear from you that has reflected for you as well. Okay, we have all sorts of questions coming in from our guests. I want to quickly answer one. There was one that came in from Marissa to Bridget asking, have grant and proposal writing coursework related at any awards yet? resulted in any awards yet? And where are sponsors typically from? And so Bridget responded for you that there's been, through books, stories, and documentaries, and on TV, she's gotten some recognition. She loves carnivores and is incredibly passionate about carnivore conservation. So again, passion being a main theme there. And for the opportunities that have been provided through the media with Zambia National Broadcasting, National Geographic, and some books. And then for help and support, she's received that from WCN, ZCP. I'm not sure what that acronym stands for, if you'd like to add that in. And then she also wanted to make sure that she weighed in on the advice to be able to provide to young conservationists, reflecting what Nelson was saying about passion, and that you should really go for it if you have that passion. And it's a challenge to have a field full of opportunities and really, really want to learn and develop and take advantage of those opportunities. So some nice answers from Bridget there. She is able to hear us. Unfortunately, the connection for her to be able to speak back with us is a little challenging. So we'll continue to take those questions and get information out to you guys. Specific questions for you, Nelson. Do you feel like, from Tammy, do you feel that human elephant conflict is still on the rise in the region, or has it eased off a little bit in the past year?
I think due to the drought we've had like major droughts in the past 3 years, I feel like conflicts have gone up, human wildlife conflicts, but more so we're coming up with like tools to mitigate human wildlife conflict. So I think climate change, which is driving like the droughts we've seen in recent years, has increased the human wildlife conflicts, especially in areas where there's agriculture and elephants coexisting side by side. Where I work in Samburu, it's mostly conflict between livestock herders and local communities and elephants. But then there's up there, there's different conflicts, but it's mainly on the rise. But then all these mitigation measures we're putting in place are helping like push it down a bit. So we're doing our best to on that side, but I'd say it's sort of increasing with like climate change and all other issues we're facing.
That's really helpful. It's unfortunate with some of the drought that there's been continued challenges, but understandably. And have you guys recently gotten rain? Are we seeing some improvement in that space recently?
Nice. Yeah. A few months ago, we had some rain, so that was a relief to both the livestock and the elephants, especially orphans. And yeah, so we're hoping the next rains will be more reliable too. So it last year and the year before that, it wasn't that good. But last year, at the end of last year, we got a bit of rain, which was quite a relief to everyone.
Mm-hmm. We have a couple more questions in here. Let me just source through them really quickly. There's one specifically from Manal asking what kind of a job you're hoping to get once you complete your PhD.
So I think my career goals are two-sided. So I do want to go into academia, especially in Kenya, because I feel like all this knowledge I'm getting needs to be passed on to local students, especially in local universities. And then the other side, I'm also hoping to continue my work with Save the Elephants. I love that job and I love working for Save the Elephants. So I'm hoping to continue working with them and, you know, taking a more role, like higher position role, hopefully up my PhD, but we'll see. I have 2 years left.
I know you've become an incredible resource for Save the Elephants, so they might just not want to let go of you that easily.
I hope so too.
For Nelson, for Marissa again, have you found tracking elephants to be more of an issue with, is there more of an issue with climate, human development, or something else? And you might have partially answered this already, but if you want to expand upon that at all.
So when we're tracking elephants, basically my PhD, I'm trying to answer your question. So I'm trying to see what's driving elephant movements so at various scales. So every year, do elephant movements change? Every year, do they change with seasons? And I think it can be, it cannot be explained by one factor. So you might say it's because of human presence, but at the same time, it's being driven by, as we have said, drought. So there are various factors that play into how elephants move, but I think the overarching one is climate change, which drives almost everything else. So it's basically a suite of factors that influence elephant movements. But keep in touch, in 2 years, I might give you a more conclusive answer.
I love the relevancy of that question, the fact that that is something that you guys don't necessarily have all the answers to. And I think that just goes to show some of the value, you know, that comes with these additional PhD programs, being able to answer some of those questions that projects have been considering for quite some time. There is a couple of questions, and I think these are more directed to myself and the WCN team. So there's a question regarding internships with a stipend for natural conservationists without a college degree. So I actually think this can probably go to both of us. So to answer on the WCN side of things, the internships that we currently support are for those that are either being hosted by our partner organizations or our wildlife funds grantees, and they design those internships entirely on their own. So there might be cases that you see internships posted that don't require you to have already received a college degree. In other cases, there are, specifically for the options that we're able to offer to some of our participants, it's for alumni that have already gone through our scholarship program. So they'll have already received a graduate degree or some graduate level training at that point. And Nelson, for you then to kind of elaborate on that as well, are there opportunities that you're aware of that would be available to students who haven't quite gotten to that level in their education yet?
Yeah, so since the elephant takes interns every 2 months, hopefully that project is still going on. So they take two international interns and two local interns, and they can stay in our camp and work for various projects. So monitoring and research wildlife, and then also the human dimensions. So they can go into the community and talk to community members. So there are a lot of opportunities even for someone who hasn't had like an education, like undergraduate or master's or PhD in conservation. So if you just apply and, you know, you might get it, because also it's very competitive. Everyone wants to like play a part in this, but yeah, there is opportunities, especially in Kenya. So we have Save the Elephants, Ewaso Lions, Gravy Zebras, all the organizations you mentioned, Laura. So they all offer internships, and I think it depends on what you're looking for, but I would say there are opportunities, and I'm evidence of that. Like I started out as an intern, and I just had before my undergrad, I volunteered a few places for climate change. And I don't think you need an education to be involved in like conservation.
I think that's really great advice. And I think not knowing where some of these questions are stemming from, if I know we've got audience members from all over the world, we've got a couple of folks that have chimed in saying that they work with you, Nelson, and they work with Bridget. So really excited to see the audience. I know it's quite late in Africa, so I'm glad that everyone's joining in. There is kind of a follow-up question to that from another audience member, Leah. With the struggle of being able to find internships that don't require you to pay to participate in them. And I know that's something that for expats, for Americans that are looking to do internships internationally, that's very common. Is that something that you find as like a Kenyan national? Are there limitations where internship opportunities require you to pay to participate in them?
Yeah, so that's one of the challenges like I faced and most Kenyans face when they're starting out in conservation. So some internships, they require you to pay to actually volunteer for them. But there are some others that you just volunteer and, you know, you don't have to pay much. And if you have to pay, you're only paying for the accommodation and the food. And which is basically, it's not that much in Kenya. So like for Save the Elephants, we do have internships that are basically free for local conservationists like Kenyans. But then we have other situations where they have to pay, like international students have to pay for food and accommodation, because that goes a long way also to offset prices for people who can't afford to volunteer. So if you can, if people who can be able to pay for the internships, they help people who cannot pay for it. So I feel like that's a very good balance for everyone to be involved.
Yeah, no, that's you know, a good explanation. And I believe that that's oftentimes the case for international internship opportunities, that those of us that are coming from countries that are considered to have some more disposable income, that it's in order to help offset the costs to be able to provide internships either for free or at a much lower cost to nationals in the region. So yeah, thank you for that. Do you have any advice to those that are trying to find those opportunities and struggling to find them? I know you mentioned a couple of programs already that are WCN partners that have internships that don't require you to pay probably at the level of concern that was being mentioned here, but just asking if you have any advice there.
I think one advice is like to follow, if you have social media, to keep in touch with like all the organizations you're interested in. They advertise all these internship and volunteer opportunities. You can also visit their websites and see their projects. So they announce internships regularly, so maybe after every 3 months. So I think the main goal is to keep in touch and keep monitoring these projects, follow their work. Even if you're not volunteering with them, just follow their reports and see what work they're doing and how much progress they're making. And once the opportunity opens up, just apply for it and don't be afraid to apply, even if you don't have all the necessary qualifications, just apply. Experience comes from, you know, volunteering.
That's really good advice. And in part, right, reaching out and asking questions and making connections, right? Because so much of the time opportunities are provided to those that show a lot of promise and a lot of interest. So yeah, if you're able to reach out to organizations that do have programs, don't hesitate to reach out and ask for some advice. If you apply and you aren't accepted, ask for feedback. You never quite know where those initial conversations are gonna take you. There are a couple additional questions that have come in for Bridget. Sly asked how one could access a wildlife conservation course and what criteria is used in Zambia. So I believe this is referencing the program that Bridget runs. And she responded saying that you can apply once the advertisement is out this year. And that can be done by looking, I believe, if I understand correctly. So Bridget, follow up if not accurate, but I believe that can be done through their website, which is zambiacarnivores.org. Additional question from Sly on that front as well. He says, they say, I understand Zambia has a lot to offer in terms of wildlife, but I don't know where I can find statistics concerning the number of animals for specific parks, animals endangered, or the types of animals to find in specific parks, et cetera. So similarly to the last response, Bridget recommends going to the Zambia Conover Program website, and you can look up their annual reports, and they have statistics on their annual reports as well. Also recommended reaching out to the Department of Natural Parks and Wildlife via the Ministry of Tourism to be able to get some of that information that you're interested in getting. So thank you for those questions, Sly, and thank you, Bridget and Bwalya, on the back end helping with getting those answers to us. And I believe we just popped into the chat a link to their annual reports as well for a quick reference point if you'd like to use that. Thank you, Megan. Nelson, back to you. Just a follow-up question on elephants specifically. So Panesh asks, to follow up on the elephant migration, have you noticed how they follow certain tree species, which may be abundant in certain areas they tend to go to?
Not a specific tree species, but they do tend to follow vegetation where there's more vegetation and rainfall. So if it rains in a specific area, they'll tend to go towards that specific area. But they also like eating some vegetation like the acacia, so they'll follow that. Like they come to our camp and they just start eating the acacias in our camp. And then there's this invasive cacti in Laikipia, the opuntia. So it's a cactus that was introduced during the long period ago. And so it's very sweet for them. So they, some of them in Laikipia tend to follow that direction and eat the cacti. But I think that might be more so in South Africa, but I'm not sure where they tend to follow certain tree species.
That's great. That's really interesting too, because I know there was some research that came out on forest elephants that suggested that they might follow specific tree species on the paths that they have in the forest. So interesting to see the difference in the different species of elephant.
Yeah.
There is, I think this is a question for us, but possibly being able to weigh in on it as well. Nelson, Panesh again asked if there are any internships for veterinarians looking to be more equipped in the conservation field with specific focus on human wildlife conflict mitigation. So Panesh, that's a fantastic question. For WCN internships, scholarships. We do have scholarships specifically for the veterinary field. Again, that's a scholarship. However, I noticed that your question specifies internships. I know of internships on the US side of things that offer opportunities to continue to grow in veterinary care, specifically exotic animal veterinary care. But Nelson, maybe you can weigh in on opportunities for wildlife vets and human wildlife conflict.
So the main organization that provides wildlife vets across Kenya is the Kenya Wildlife Service. So they have their main vets, and then these main vets have assistants who are local veterinarian students, but I also think they do take international vet students or people who are interested in that field. But it's basically Kenya Wildlife Service who manages the vet services. So if you're interested in that opportunity, I'd suggest looking at the Kenya Wildlife Service website and see whether they have vet opportunities for maybe internships or volunteer work.
Yeah, that's great advice. Thank you. I have a little bit of a clarification on one of the Bridget questions that I gave an answer to, just regarding the specific program that she runs for young conservationists. It's who is accepted into those programs is based on institution recommendations. And so, if you have an interest in that and you're working in a conservation field or you are, in a university, connecting with potentially some of your mentors to be able to reach out to Zambian Carnivore Project to gain some more information and get some recommendations on how to potentially participate is how I'm understanding that. Thank you, Bridget. I think we are just about at time. I know there was a slew of questions to you, Nelson. Thank you so much for answering them. Bridget, enormous thanks for writing out your responses in real time. Balia, who's our career program manager, is in the background transferring information back and forth between all of us right now, which is fantastic. It really is quite a fun network that we all work in. In closing, I wanted to make sure that we not only thanked Bridget and Nelson, but that we thanked every single one of you on this call today. Thank you so much for joining us. If you were inspired by either the WCN programs or Save the Elephants or Zambia Carnivore Project programs, you can learn more about them on our website. You can also donate on our website, and that's wildnet.org. There are no donations that are too small and there are none too big. 100% of designated funds go directly to the conservation programs of your choice. So you can go in there and identify specifically. I will note for Bridget that because they are not a partner, that goes through our Lion Recovery Fund. So you might need to make some specification on what program specifically you're interested in. But we will be following up with an email to everyone on this call. And so you can ask us questions directly or share your interests, and we'll make sure that we get you connected to the right people. If you'd like to learn more about WCN and any of our programs, you can also sign up for our newsletter on that same webpage. I encourage you to do that. That's how we find out about these Closer Look opportunities coming out. And then please join us for the next Closer Look call, which is going to be on March 17th. It's with the Andean Cat Alliance and Cheetah Conservation Botswana, both of which are also incredibly amazing, like all of our partners. I encourage you to join. And they're going to be speaking about their livestock guarding dogs programs. There's a link in the chat, I believe, or will be shortly, for you to register if you're interested. Thank you so, so much for joining us today. Please reach out if you have any questions, and we look forward to seeing you again soon. Have a wonderful rest of your day, guys.
Thank you.
Tamaño vía, mi cuadro bueno me va, que hace moloca.